Hello everyone, I'm Brad Berzer, and this is the Spirit of Cecilia Videocast number 3. I am recording this on January 11th of 2020. It's a grim Michigan day, and somewhat of a somber post because I just found out yesterday, as did the world, we found out late yesterday afternoon that the great drummer and lyricist for Rush, one of the greatest rock bands that ever existed, Neil Peart, passed away on Tuesday, January 7th, after fighting brain cancer for 3.5 years. That whole understanding was kept very secret by the family and friends and the band, and none of us knew until yesterday. So what a loss. I can't even imagine a world without Neil Peart in it. He's been an important part of my life since back in the spring of 1981. So all the way back then, Neil Peart has been a huge influence on my life. I even have his little Funko Pop guy here. Here's Neil back in the 1970s, at least the representation of Neil back in the 1970s, as Funko Pop imagined him with his little kimono and his drumsticks and his crazy mustache and his crazy 70s hair. But what a great guy. I have to read from one of my favorite authors on Peart, a guy by the name of Robert Friedman, who wrote an excellent book on the history of Rush. And he wrote this right before the 40th anniversary of Rush, so it would have been right before 2014. He writes, "The story of Rush is a story of validation. When the band first started out, the mainstream music establishment largely ignored them. Getty's voice was the brunt of jokes. Alex's guitar playing got no respect. Neil's lyrics were pretentious and channeled a kooky Ayn Randian ideology, and he played too many drums, all of them with the precision of a mathematician. Meanwhile, musicians and music aficionados loved them, so you had this great narrative tension. Now they're nearing their 40th anniversary, their old critics are in nursing homes, their fans are in leadership positions in business, science, government, and the arts, and they've looked as elder statesmen of rock." You know, what an incredible tribute, and Friedman just nails it. When we were growing up in the 1980s, Rush was everything to us. So I first encountered the band because I was in detention in 7th grade in junior high, Liberty Junior High in Hutchinson, Kansas, and I was wearing a little Genesis Duke pin and got thrown into detention with two friends of mine, Troy and Brad. I don't remember at all what we were doing at the time. We were probably talking too much, but we got thrown into detention, and after talking a little bit about progressive rock, these guys said to me, "Have you heard of Rush and their new album, Moving Pictures?" And of course, I had not. I had grown up in a house with progressive rock. I knew of Jethro Tull and Yes and Kansas, but I'd not heard of Rush. And so that afternoon, despite having been in trouble at Liberty Junior High, I rode my bike down to the local record store. I had my lawn mowing money, and I purchased Moving Pictures. And I went home, and it changed my life in every way. Neil Peart's ideas about life, his integrity, his lyrics, they all shaped me as profoundly as anything I read by J.R.R. Tolkien or Ray Bradbury or Ursula Le Guin or any of my other great heroes of grade school and junior high. Leon Uris. Later, because of debate, I would read Milton Friedman and Friedrich Hayek and Henry Hazlitt, and all of them are kind of as a whole to me. That is, when I think of Neil Peart, I don't separate him as rock musician and Milton Friedman as economist. They were both so influential on my life in trying to define who and what I was. So, you know, I don't mean to do this as self-promotion, because obviously part of my life has been dealing with Neil Peart, and the timing is right. He passed away. So I wrote a book in 2015 for Kevin J. Anderson, also a great friend of mine, one of the greatest science fiction writers, if not the greatest science fiction writer of our day, who was a good friend of Neil Peart. I wrote a biography of Neil Peart, and I tried to describe exactly what Peart meant to me after I'd gone through his own history and biography. And I wrote at the beginning, "For most of us who admire Peart, we cannot directly show just how his words or his character or his music or his personality have affected us on a day-to-day basis. As I mentioned at the beginning of this book, I first encountered the music of Rush in 1981 when I was just 13. At that time, my family life was not just dysfunctional, it was violent, chaotic, and suffocating. Like any teenager, I was struggling to find who I was, but I also had to figure out how to survive. And please believe me, survival back in 1981 in my family was not a sure thing. Don't have to go into details about that. Just know that I have a stepfather who spent time, justly in my opinion, in prison. Home was hell. But moving pictures and signals gave me great strength and grace under pressure, Rush's 1984 album, even more so. Peart had stated repeatedly that he doesn't always appreciate his fans and their rabidity, especially the fanatics and those who read secret messages in his lyrics. I never read anything into his lyrics except this: be yourself, find your gifts, hone your gifts, and always wield integrity fiercely. And all of this should be no matter the cost. I never once felt that Peart wanted to make the world a world of little Pearts, each conforming to his image. Rather, as all true individualists, Peart wanted to leaven all through his own excellence and remind us of the most important things in life. And this he did, at least for me, and I think for many of my generation and the generation after me. Peart wanted to make a world not of little Pearts, ones that conform to his image, but rather as a true individualist, he wanted to leaven all through his excellence and remind us of the important things in life, as I just mentioned. And this he did. Throughout my life, Peart's words have reminded me of the most important things, whether he wrote these words in lyrics, in books, or spoke them in interviews. Peart always made me more myself, not less. And while I cannot prove it, I'm pretty sure I speak for thousands upon thousands of others. Yesterday afternoon, when the news broke that Neil Peart had passed away on Tuesday, social media was just filled, and it remains so this morning, just filled with tributes to the great man and his work. I know that he personally never liked a lot of attention on his life, but now that his life is done and he's moved on to the next world, I think we can openly appreciate, radically appreciate this great man, a man who was always himself, a man who lived through great tragedy and survived, a man who suffered and made something better of his suffering, a man who never once stopped to make himself mediocre, but always strove to pursue excellence in every single thing he did, whether it was playing the drums, performing in concert, or writing down his great thoughts. Neil Peart, 1952 to 2020, I thank you. My life would not be the same. My life wouldn't even be close to the same without your words, without your example, and without your integrity. May God bless you, and may you spend eternity happy in a loving care and in loving embrace of all that is good and true, that is beautiful. And thank you again for everything.
A Monday warrior, mean strike. Today's Tom Sawyer, mean.